This is you. It's June 27th, 2016, and you just dropped a track to celebrate reaching 2,000 followers on SoundCloud. It doesn't feel quite as special as hitting the coveted 1,000 follower milestone, but you're still proud nonetheless. But you do wonder, how long will it take to get your next 1,000 followers? A year? Maybe 6 months if you're lucky? Well, what if I told you by this time next year, you will have amassed not just another 1,000 followers, but over 20,000. Not only that, but by 2020, you'll be one of the few funk producers to have tracks with over 1 million streams on SoundCloud. Most aspiring SoundCloud producers, especially in such a niche genre, could only dream of such explosive growth. But for one lucky artist, this dream would become reality, marking one of the most meteoric rises in SoundCloud producer history. The seemingly overnight success of DJ Young Vamp has intrigued the funk community for years. One day he was just one of the little guys, still finding his sound and collaborating with other up-and-comers like Young Caster and Shelter. But the next thing you knew, he was at the forefront of the genre, making a name for himself and working with funk legends like Soutier, Jason Rich, and DJ Smokey. So how'd he do it? We've all heard that success is achieved through both talent and luck. And while Vamp's craft certainly played a role in his success, the most obvious contributor to his rise was the emergence of the funk scene on YouTube. Just as Vamp's tracks started gaining some traction in the funk community on SoundCloud, promotional YouTube channels like Emotional Tokyo, Ryan Celsius, and Rare were beginning to dabble in funk. The timing couldn't have been more perfect for Vamp. The first, yes the very first, Trappin' in Heaven mix was uploaded in November of 2016. The video was met with overwhelming success, garnering over 1.6 million views in 5 months. The first track on the mix? Hopped Up by DJ Young Vamp and Beside You. Then, Trappin' in Japan 3 was uploaded in April of 2017, amassing over 2 million views in a year. The first track on this mix? Blessing by DJ Young Vamp. And that same month, Rare would upload what would later become one of the most viewed videos on his channel. The song, Godfather by, you guessed it, DJ Young Vamp. Vamp's steady growth within the funk scene in late 2016 created a positive feedback loop where his songs would gain traction on SoundCloud, then the songs would get picked up by YouTube promoters, which would then drive even more traffic to his SoundCloud, and so on. It also didn't hurt that Hopped Up, the track that started it all, was a collab with Beside You, who at the time was quickly becoming one of the most prominent producers in the rapidly growing lo-fi scene. Like I said, the timing was just perfect. While I do think lucky timing played a big role in Vamp's success, not just anyone could have pulled it off. After all, other up-and-comers like Soutier and Paolo were featured in a lot of those YouTube mixes, and they weren't helped by them nearly as much as Vamp was. DJ Young Vamp was uniquely prepared to reap the success of YouTube funk mixes because of his simple production style. His tracks typically didn't involve many layers, often using just a handful of drums, a couple sound effects, a main sample, and a main vocal. With fewer sounds to account for, the mixing was pretty straightforward too. And there's also the fact that Vamp typically used generic sounds that were readily available to most people, like the Young Chop snare and the Nextel chirp sound effect, both of which could be found in most free drum kits across the internet. Unlike most funk producers at the time, Vamp also used mainstream vocal samples and acapellas. Since his tracks used common sounds and weren't too complex, aspiring funk producers could listen to his music and think, I can do that. By implicitly encouraging imitation, his discography was not only uniquely inspiring, but also a direct contrast to his contemporaries, who prided themselves on using rare sounds that were nearly impossible to track down. Even if you didn't know what song Vamp had sampled his vocals from, all you'd have to do is Google the lyrics to find out. And that technique doesn't really work for the obscure Memphis vocals used by Soutier and others at the time. In a genre where the vast majority of listeners are also producers, it makes sense that someone with such a replicable production style would take off, especially when paired with the positive feedback loop created by the YouTube promoters. But what about listeners who weren't producers? What did they see in his music? Well, in addition to its high capacity for imitation, Vamp's music also carried with it a strong sense of familiarity for general audiences. For newcomers to the funk genre, Vamp's mainstream vocals were certainly more approachable than the gritty Memphis vocals used by other artists. And while the Simpsons cover art aesthetic was wildly popular among most funk producers at the time, Vamp was uniquely positioned to take advantage of it, as it further enhanced the sense of familiarity and nostalgia evoked by his vocal selection. There's also no denying that general audiences would find comfort in the stylistic consistency of Vamp's music. From track to track, listeners could generally expect him to follow the same formula: simple, punchy drums on top of a slow jazz sample with a modern, mainstream vocal. When deciding whether or not to follow an artist, perhaps one of the biggest factors is whether you expect their future work to match what they've already done. Vamp made that decision easy for listeners by displaying a rigidly consistent style across most of his releases during that time. Followers knew exactly what they were gonna get next. Big name collaborations added fuel to the fire. By the end of 2017, he had worked with three of the scene's most prominent producers: DJ Smokey, Jason Rich, and Soutier, who recruited him to Purple Posse shortly after. But there was also a dark side to the increased interest in collaboration. Naturally, dozens of other smaller producers wanted the opportunity to work with him too, even if it meant paying. This led to multiple producers accusing Vamp of unfulfilled promises and fraudulent activity. But nonetheless, his rapid growth continued in 2018, racking up an additional 20,000 followers that year as well. By 2020, Vamp's growth has mellowed out somewhat, with the funk scene reaching maturity on both SoundCloud and YouTube. Nonetheless, he still enjoys his position as one of the funk heavyweights. Soon, his follower count may even eclipse that of DJ Smokey, making him the new most followed artist in the genre. Follower count isn't everything, but I think it's an interesting indicator of an audience's interest changing over time. While no funk producer has come close to recreating the growth that Vamp experienced, I don't know if it's even possible anymore. His 20,000 follower invasion was created by the perfect storm of circumstances, namely the funk genre's explosive introduction on YouTube, his replicable production style, and his mainstream appeal. About the closest anyone's come in recent years is Roland Jones, who's managed to rack up about 6,000 followers in the last year. He mirrors some aspects of Vamp, both in his straightforward, aggressive production and occasional use of mainstream vocals, so it's possible that's part of the reason why. Whatever the case, there's no mistaking that Vamp's growth from 2016 to 17 was quite remarkable. Though unlikely, I'm excited to see if someone does manage to pop off like he did. He achieved something most funk producers only dream of. But until then, I guess they'll just have to keep dreaming. Thanks so much for watching, guys. The support on the Purple Posse video was unreal, so I'm definitely going to keep doing these. So if you're new here and want to see more like this, be sure to subscribe. As always, if you have an idea for a topic I should cover next, let me know in the comments. See you guys in the next one. Peace.